It is now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, may I begin by congratulating you on your re-election as Speaker in this chamber. Congratulations and best wishes. And also, Premier, congratulations to you and your government. An historic win, as you are the first female Premier in the province of Ontario, a fact that we are all proud of. And best wishes, but not too many best wishes. So my question, Mr. Speaker, is for the Premier. Premier, your throne speech promises another $5.7 billion worth of new programs with money we don't have, racking up a record $12.5 billion deficit. Irresponsible and unaccountable spending will never lead to balancing the budget and getting Ontario's economy growing again. According to economist Jack Mintz, quote, if interest rates, which have been at 20-year low levels, rise, the debt burden would become significantly heavier. And if interest rates rise to even historic norms, each point increase in interest could add a minimum of $3 billion in annual interest payments, which would severely cripple Ontario's ability to deliver services. End of quote. Premier, you claim you will eliminate the deficit in 3 years, yet you're promising to spend billions more in new money, taxpayers' money.
Question.
Will you commit today to complete openness and transparency as you implement your plan with billions in new spending?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I too want to congratulate you on your re-election as Speaker, and I want to congratulate the member for Simcoe Grey for his position as the Leader of the Opposition, and to all of the members of the House, congratulations to them, and all of the candidates who put their names on a ballot and ran. I want to say thank you for taking part in the democratic process. Thank you very much. I want to answer the last part of the Leader of the Opposition's question first by saying that, yes, we intend and we will operate in a very transparent manner, Mr. Speaker. We will conduct business in a very open way, and I think that as we reintroduce pieces of legislation, Mr. Speaker, particularly the Accountability Act, that will be obvious that that is the way that we want to operate. But I also want to say to both the Leader of the Opposition and to the Leader of the Third Party that it is still our intention and it is our responsibility to operate in a collaborative way so that where there are possibilities of finding the best answer to questions of serious public policy in Ontario, we want to draw on ideas from all sides of the House, Mr. Speaker. That is our responsibility as government, and we take it very seriously.
Well, Premier, my colleagues and I here on the opposition side are concerned that this government spending spree will dig us into such a deep hole that someday we won't be able to afford the basic things we all care about, like health care and education. As you know, Moody's credit rating agency changed Ontario's debt rating outlook from stable to negative. A credit downgrade would increase our borrowing costs, taking money out of the front
order, please.
We all depend on. Already, 40 nursing positions have been cut in North Bay, 90 nurses put out of work in Ottawa, and you fired 34 nurses in Windsor. Premier, will you do the honourable thing and tell Ontarians what further frontline services you're going to cut in order to meet your budget targets? Or are you simply going to pass the buck on to future generations with the debt burden?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I fundamentally disagree with the premise of the question that the Leader of the Opposition has put forward. First of all, I think he knows full well there are more than 20,000 new nurses in Ontario since we've come into office, Mr. Speaker, since 2003. Net new positions, Mr. Speaker. So there are thousands of new nurses. What we are doing, Mr. Speaker, is we are transforming the system. That is what is necessary. We have a plan to build Ontario up, Mr. Speaker, and that's where the fundamental disagreement is. We know that the investments that are necessary right now will lead to that future economic growth, Mr. Speaker. We know that the transformations and the investments in health care today will lead to the excellence in health care that we need today and tomorrow, Mr. Speaker. So those investments in training and in skills, the investments in infrastructure, including hospitals and schools, roads and bridges and transit, those are the things that need to be done now, Mr. Speaker, in order to build the province up.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Premier, this crisis is yours. This was born out of your Liberal government's inability to make the tough decisions and get Ontario's finances under control. But for years, you've sat on your hands and you've even continually made matters worse. Again, Jack Mintz has said, quote, Ontario is sagging under the weight of monstrous public debt, uncompetitive energy prices, and rising taxes, end of quote. You've ignored your financial mess for too long, and now Ontario families are left holding the bag for your poor management and refusal to get a grip on the province's finances. Premier, just be honest. You've started with cuts to physiotherapy services for seniors and firing nurses. What other frontline services are you going to cut, or what taxes are you going to increase?
Thank you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I'm not sure exactly whether the Leader of the Opposition is asking for more spending or less spending, but here's the reality. We are providing more physiotherapy services, Mr. Speaker. We are providing better home care services, Mr. Speaker. We are transforming the health care system. But most importantly, we are making sure that we don't begin this next phase of Ontario's economic history by cutting 100,000 jobs, by cutting services, Mr. Speaker. What we are doing is we are investing in the services that we know people need, that affect their quality of life. We are investing in their talent and their skills and those of their children and their grandchildren, Mr. Speaker. We are investing in the roads and the bridges and the transit systems that they will need. And I would hope, Mr. Speaker, that we will have the support of the opposition, because they know full well that in every community across Ontario, those services and those investments are necessary.
Thank you. New question. The member from Whitby, Oshawa.
Congratulations, Minister, on your new appointment. Minister, London Hospital emergency room wait times are among the worst in the province. The provincial average for complex conditions wait times in an emergency room is 9.9 hours. However, at University Hospital, the wait time in emergency room for complex conditions is 19 hours. At the London Health Science Centre's Victoria Hospital, the wait time for complex conditions is 12.6 hours. Minister, why are London's emergency room wait times so far above the provincial average?
Okay. Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question. And clearly, there is a problem at this hospital, and we're working with the hospital to work to decrease the wait times, the ER wait times. But I'm proud, in fact, that we measure wait times, that the previous government, in terms of many aspects of health care services, were not even measured. So, and we not only measured them, but we've made considerable progress right across the province in reducing the wait times for ER, reducing the wait times as well for important surgical procedures in the province. In fact, in 2008, 5 years ago, we launched a coordinated and very comprehensive strategy to do just what the member opposite is asking, to tackle the coordinated strategy to tackle our ER wait times, working with health care professionals right across the province to make sure that we continue to make progress. Mr. Speaker, we are making progress with the particular institution referenced. There's clearly much more work that needs to be done.
Exactly.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, simply measuring the wait times doesn't do it. You actually have to do something about it. And in fact, this past winter, the emergency room wait times were so bad that the London hospitals told people to stay away from the emergency rooms unless that was absolutely necessary. But there is an answer here. 30 kilometres down the road, the emergency room at St. Thomas Elgin General Hospital has some of the lowest wait times in the province. St. Thomas has some of the best patient management systems in Ontario, and they're very efficient at moving patients through the system. St. Thomas's CEO, Paul Collins, believes this system is transferable to all London hospitals. Minister, will you commit to implementing the system used at St. Thomas Elgin's Hospital to all of the London area hospitals?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, I'm sure even the member opposite will acknowledge that the situation in those two jurisdictions is different, but I want to talk to her about and mention how I'm proud that ER wait times across the province have gone down 12% in Ontario over the last 5 years. Yeah. In fact, ER wait times for the sickest patients that do show up in our ERs have gone down by 29.3%, while at the same time, volumes for those most ill, most sick individuals have increased by 39%. Yeah. So we've made tremendous progress there, to the point where 9 out of every 10 patients that are treated in our ERs are treated within the target times. Yeah. 85% of complex patients within 8 hours of arriving in our ERs, and 89% of uncomplicated patients are seen and treated within 4 hours, Mr. Speaker. So we've made tremendous progress. Clearly, there's more work to be done, including in individual hospitals. We are doing that work.
That's right.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, London's head of emergency medicine, Dr. Gary Joubert, was quoted saying, "We're not as terrible as the provincial numbers indicate." Really, Minister, that's a pretty low bar. Not as terrible. Doesn't give a lot of comfort to people who need emergency room services in London. You indicated that you realize that there are two very different operating systems. The Elgin Hospital, St. Thomas Hospital, has a great system. Will you commit today, Minister, to implementing the same system used at St. Thomas Hospital in all the London hospitals? It clearly works. Why wouldn't you do it?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. And again, Mr. Speaker, we look everywhere for good advice on how we can continue to reduce the ER wait times. And I want to say as well, specific to London Health Sciences, we've provided them with over $1 million recently to help them reduce their ER wait times even further. And part of our plan, of course, is to transition out of hospital those individuals who can be better cared for outside of hospital. Because one of the challenges with our ER wait times
member from Dufferin Caledon.
Beds for those individuals that have complex problems, for beds for them to go into immediately. So as we move people out of hospitals, we can move people from our ERs into that. That will open up ER time. And we're working closely, with the London Health Services. We see that more progress needs to be made. We'll work hard until we're proud of the results and the people of that jurisdiction of London.
The member from Elgin, Middlesex, London, come to order. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, on behalf of New Democrats, I want to begin by congratulating you on your election, the Premier on her election and forming of a government, all the MPPs on their election to this place, as well as those candidates that ran in this campaign. It was an exciting campaign and wanted to extend my congratulations. My question, of course, Speaker, is to the Premier. The Premier spent the recent election campaign denouncing Conservative plans to fire 100,000 public sector workers. Can she explain why Don Drummond says that that's
Minister
exactly
of Agriculture,
what her
come
plan
to
will do, Speaker?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I want to especially congratulate the new members, the new NDP members, and congratulate them on their run and for being here in the House, Mr. Speaker. And I have to say, I'm somewhat concerned about the rhetoric that I'm hearing from the leader of the NDP, Mr. Speaker. It sounds like she's looking for an excuse for why she didn't support our budget, Mr. Speaker, because she knows perfectly well that the investments that we put forward in our budget are necessary to the people of Ontario, Mr. Speaker. She knows that investing in people's talent and skills and investing in infrastructure, including transit and roads and bridges, Mr. Speaker, she knows that that's necessary. And she knows that an Ontario Retirement Pension Plan, Mr. Speaker, is what is needed in the absence of the federal government stepping up to enhance the CPP. So, Mr. Speaker, I hope that she will support those initiatives that we are putting forward. She knows full well that the people of Ontario need them and support them, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, I would actually hope that the Premier would respond to my question, so I'm going to put it again. When the Conservatives introduced a plan to fire 100,000 people, the Premier called that plan disastrous. Now, does the Premier think the message that voters sent is that they don't want the Conservatives to fire 100,000 people, but it's okay for the Liberals to fire 100,000 people?
So, again, Mr. Speaker, I believe that the leader of the third party is looking for some reason, anywhere she can find it, to justify why she didn't support our budget, Mr. Speaker. And she talks about comments made by Mr. Drummond, and she knows perfectly well that that is not what he said. She knows perfectly well that our plan is not premised on firing 100,000 people. That was the Conservatives' plan, Mr. Speaker. And, you know, it's interesting because the NDP leader based her plan on the same fiscal targets that we had put out, Mr. Speaker, except that she said she'd find $600 million more dollars, Mr. Speaker. So, in fact, she knows full well that it is not our intention to fire people. She knows full well that our plan is premised on building people up, building up the province, including the infrastructure and the talent and skills of the people of this province.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. You know, the government seems intent on reintroducing their Trojan horse budget, despite the fact that people have rejected
austerity and mass layoffs.
Order. Order.
Please finish.
Economists are telling people to brace for the worst, Speaker, because there are major gaps in the government's fiscal plan that have not been explained.
Member from Glengarry, Prescott, Russell will come to order.
Will the Premier come clean with Ontarians, Speaker, and tell them to brace for the worst?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, we have been very upfront with the people of Ontario. We have said, Mr. Speaker, we have said that there are challenges confronting us. There is no doubt about that. We have said that there are constraints that we have to keep in place. We have said that there is no new money for collective agreements, Mr. Speaker, as we go into negotiations. We have said quite clearly that the kinds of changes that we have been making in the health care system, the changes in the delivery of service, putting more services in the community, we've said that those changes need to continue. But, Mr. Speaker, for the leader of the third party to stand up when she based her plan on exactly the same fiscal foundation as we did, Mr. Speaker, for her to stand up now and to distance herself from that is ridiculous, Mr. Speaker. The fact is, we know that there are challenges ahead, but we also know that we must make the investments that are necessary in order to build this province up and to help this economy grow, Mr. Speaker. That's what people expect.
Thank you. New question, leader of the third party.
Speaker, my next question is also to the Premier. Last week, Moody's changed their outlook on Ontario's credit rating to negative after the government said it would
Minister without portfolio, come to order.
After the government said it would reintroduce the same budget. Does the Premier accept that anyone who has taken a look at the numbers behind the Liberal plan see that there is a major gap?
Thank you, Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, we laid out a path to balance in our budget, and what we ran on, what we said that we were going to do, and what we are doing, Mr. Speaker, is reintroducing a plan that will keep us on target to balance the budget and eliminate the deficit by 2017-18, Mr. Speaker, and we will make the investments now that we know are necessary in order for the province to thrive, Mr. Speaker. And with all due respect to the leader of the third party, I would have expected that she would understand by now that people want those investments, that people believe that those investments are necessary, and they know because they live in their communities that their kids need those supports, that their communities and their businesses need those supports. I would have thought she'd have heard that, Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
New question. Sorry. Supplementary.
Speaker, does the Premier at least accept that in the wake of the downgrade, the negative outlook from Moody's, that the Liberal plan suffers from a serious credibility gap?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, we have been crystal clear that in order to eliminate the deficit by 2017-18, that there will be difficult decisions. Mr. Speaker, I've been clear, the Minister of Finance has been clear, that, for example, there is no new money for collective agreements, Mr. Speaker. We know that those rounds of collective bargaining will be challenging, Mr. Speaker, but we've been crystal clear about that. Everyone went into this with their eyes wide open. We know, Mr. Speaker, that there will have to be changes in the way we deliver services. Some of those changes are already underway, Mr. Speaker, particularly in the health care system. But that does not negate the fact that there need to be investments in this province. That does not negate the fact that kids need full-day kindergarten, that seniors need services in health care, Mr. Speaker, that more home care is necessary, that we must have personal support workers who are paid adequately, and that people with developmental services need support. Those are the things that we know we need investment right now.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, when is the Premier
of this province going to level with Ontarians about the cuts, the layoffs, and the asset sales that they can expect to see from this government's Trojan horse budget?
Well, Mr. Speaker, anyone who has read the budget knows that we reference every one of those issues, Mr. Speaker, and how we will take them on. And you know, for example, on assets, Mr. Speaker, what we have said is that we believe that those assets that are in the hands of government that belong to the people of Ontario, that they should work for the people of Ontario to the very, very optimal degree, Mr. Speaker, which is why we've asked Ed Clark, Mr. Speaker, to take on the challenge of making sure those assets work. And I hear heckling from the opposition, Mr. Speaker. Had there been a process in place when the 407 was being considered, Mr. Speaker, had we had that asset work for us, I'll bet it would not have been sold and we wouldn't have lost those billions of dollars. So we're taking a rational approach, Mr. Speaker. We're going to make sure that the assets that are owned by the people of Ontario work for the people of Ontario, and we are going to make the investments in services that we know people need, and I hope that the third party will join us in support of those, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from Leeds Grenville.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Seated, please. Seated, please. Order.
Member from Leeds Grenville.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Congratulations on your re-election. My question through you is to the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. Minister, congratulations on your re-election and your appointment to Cabinet. In just a little over a week, the Kempville College Renewal Task Force will convene a public meeting to discuss potential partnerships to provide and ensure core agriculture education programs continue to be offered in Eastern Ontario. What the ag community wants from you is your assurance that you and your government will work with any partner with a plan to deliver those programs that comes out of that public meeting. Will you give that assurance to us today?
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Rural Affairs and Food.
Well, thanks very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Leeds Grenville for the question this morning. There's no question in my mind that both Kempville and Alfred play significant roles in the agricultural community in Eastern Ontario. In fact, Mr. Speaker, in my riding of Peterborough, I have a number of alumni, particularly from the Kempville College, and they've been calling me consistently over the last little while. And we're looking at ways to foster partnerships in both those communities at Kempville and Alfred, because we know their importance. And we do know that two individuals, the Honourable Lyle Van Cleef, will be doing an extensive review of Kempville, and Mark Goubon will be doing an extensive community review of Alfred. And I look forward to working with the member from Leeds Grenville and my colleague from Gregory Prescott and Russell as we move forward with a positive plan, both for Kempville and for Alfred.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thanks very much, Speaker. Minister, this is a very simple answer. It's a yes or no answer. Well, there is. Several partners, including the municipality of North Grenville, have stepped up to be part of the solution. Others are going to be revealed at that public meeting next week. Can you assure us that your facilitator will implement our community's plan with any potential partner that comes out in that meeting? Are you committed to Kempville? Are you going to force your vision of Kempville on that facilitator? Or are you going to allow him to listen to the community and work with the task force?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for supplementary. We'll be working very carefully with all the partners or potential partners in those areas. We have appointed two very distinguished Canadians to help us with the review. The Honourable Lyle Van Cleef, who was a very, very distinguished Minister of Agriculture for Prime Minister Chrétien. Mark Goubon, who has extensive agricultural credentials in Eastern Ontario. So one of the things, Mr. Speaker, that I learned in almost 30 years in public life, serving the great folks of Peterborough, that you need to listen very carefully. And over the next number of weeks and months, I'll be listening very carefully to the people in the Kempville area, and the people in Alfred area to come up with the right solution, a sustainable solution for those
Answer.
Two wonderful
Answer.
Agriculture institutions in Eastern Ontario.
Thank you. Your question? The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. This question is to the Premier. In addition to Moody's, Standard & Poor's also has a negative outlook for Ontario's credit rating. As you know, our credit rating is important because it can impact our ability to invest in education and health care, key ideas in the activist centre. With two agencies shifting to negative outlook, the risk of a downgrade is growing, and it shouldn't be ignored. What is the government doing to restore confidence in the province's public finances?
Minister of Finance. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. Congratulations to the member for being the critic for finance. And it's important to recognize, and I'm certainly offer my opportunity to meet with you so I can go over some of the issues as they may pertain to the portfolio. We recognize that it's important to continue to invest in the things that makes us competitive in the long term. Recognizing that we will control spending. In fact, we are the lowest cost government in Canada because of the measures that we've taken. We are the leanest government. We're the only government to actually have cut spending year over year. We've adopted over 80% of Don Drummond's recommendations, and we're continuing to find savings in the system by appointing a new president of the Treasury Board whose mandate it is to provide for those negotiations going forward and to find even greater savings in the system. That is how we're going to get to our path to balance, but an important part of that balance is ensuring that we grow our economy, invest in those initiatives that will enable
Answer.
Us to grow our revenue by growing the economy. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
You, supplementary.
Thank you, and I appreciate the invitation to meet with the Minister of Finance and also the Minister of Treasury Board. I look forward to working with you as well. But there are some realities that we're going to have to face together. At a time when ratings agencies have Ontario on a negative outlook, a shot across the bow, that's how they've described the fiscal situation in the province of Ontario, the government's plan is still moving ahead.
Member from Eglinton Lawrence, come to order.
By opening new tax loopholes for corporations and exempt them from paying HST on entertainment, entertaining clients, on buying luxury cars. This is not a priority for the people of the province of Ontario. At a time when Ontario is under fiscal pressure, why is the government intent on opening up new tax loopholes for corporations? This does not make sense.
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, I reject the premise of the question because that's not the case. What is important is for us to ensure that we find ways to grow the revenue by growing our economy. We're looking at all ways by which we can secure greater stability in our economy. And we do that by not taking extreme measures. We must also recognize that in order for us to balance the books, we must control our spending, but also invest in those things that will make us competitive. You referenced something that is not opening up any tax loopholes. They are existing and they require support with the federal government. That is why we're taking steps to look at underground economy, other efforts by which to grow our revenue, things that exist that we can improve upon. And we're taking measures and we're looking at ways that Quebec has done in terms of the underground economy. That'll help us capture and grow the revenue in that case as well. But as also mentioned, Mr. Speaker, we have just appointed
Answer.
Ed Clark to look at our assets to maximize the opportunity to increase our dividends through those Crown corporations, all of which will help, again, to balance our budget by 2017-18, which we're on track. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
New question? The member from Kitchener Senate.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. Mr. Speaker, our province has made strategic investments in innovation hubs, which are helping today's entrepreneurs become tomorrow's global leaders. And that type of investment is key, especially in supporting cluster development and regional economies. We see this in Kitchener-Waterloo. We see it in the greater Ottawa area, Durham, and the GTA, where we have some of the world's cutting-edge innovation parks, including Mars, right across the street from here. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please provide the House with some information on how Mars is creating good jobs for the province of Ontario?
Absolutely.
Thank you, Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member for Kitchener Centre for being the first new member in this new legislature to ask a question in this legislature. It's a good question. Mr. Speaker, it's important to understand that this government has recognized the need for Ontario to build on its strengths, our people and our partnerships. MARS is focused on building Canada's next generation of technology companies and accelerating these firms to the status of global market leaders. MARS is globally recognized as one of North America's largest urban research parks and is home to more than 115 tenants from across the innovation spectrum, where about 2,500 people work every day. Over 1,400 startup companies have been incubated or advised at MARS since its inception, and in 2013 alone, MARS venture clients created more than 6,500 jobs.
Answer.
In total, Mr. Speaker, MARS clients have generated more than $3 billion in economic activity. Mr. Speaker, this government believes in supporting a dynamic and innovative business climate, and MARS is a key part to doing
that. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for his answer. There's no doubt about the importance of this kind of investment in our province in creating cluster development and helping to fortify our regional economies. As the Minister detailed in his answer, MARS has definitely had a very positive effect on these regional economies and our economy as a whole. However, in recent weeks, we have read a number of stories about the future of MARS Phase 2. I understand that decisions about the future of the MARS Phase 2 building were not made during the writ process. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could the Minister please provide us with an update on what, if any, decisions he has made about MARS Phase 2?
Good question. Excellent.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, a very, very good and pertinent question. Mr. Speaker, I think it's really important. We all have a responsibility to do our due diligence to ensure that the next steps of MARS Phase 2 are carried out with the utmost respect for transparency and taxpayers' dollars. At this moment, Mr. Speaker, let me be very clear, no decisions have been made. And before any decision is made, I'm making the commitment to solicit the best advice and expertise from industry on how to proceed. The matter the member refers to does have significant complexity to it. I'm currently in the process of reviewing all options for MARS Phase 2, and I can assure the member that I'm looking at the matter closely and will ensure that any decisions that are made will be done as transparently as possible. The government's priority is creating jobs and building a strong next-generation economy. Ontario is fast becoming a global leader in innovation.
Answer.
MARS plays a key role in getting us there, Mr. Speaker. This decision will be made in a way that best serves our innovation agenda, our economy, and Ontario taxpayers.
Thank you. New question, the member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Premier, last session I worked very hard to try to get my private member's bill, Ryan's Law, passed through committee so that it could be into law before the election. Unfortunately, Premier, this didn't occur. I will be reintroducing Ryan's Law, which will protect the 20% of students with asthma. However, with a majority government, opposition bills tend to get shelved regardless of how vital they are. I hope this doesn't happen with Ryan's Law, Premier, because it would suggest that your government would be willing to sacrifice the safety of our children in order to deny a Tory MPP bill. Premier, Ryan's Law is important. It will protect children with asthma, and it's that simple. Premier, when I reintroduce Ryan's Law, will you commit to doing everything you can to ensure its quick passage?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to commend the member for putting forward this legislation. I think that private members' bills are extremely important, and from my perspective, as I said earlier, it doesn't matter where good ideas come from, Mr. Speaker, and if we can find ways to help kids in schools who have asthma to be safer, Mr. Speaker, then obviously we have to do that. So the committee that will be looking at, I assume the member opposite will reintroduce Ryan's Law, will reintroduce this piece of legislation, and the committee will need to look at it, and as I said, Mr. Speaker, if we can find ways to make sure that kids in schools, kids who have asthma, are safer, then we have an obligation to do that, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker. Premier, the best way to ensure this bill gets passed is to ensure that your House leader works to get my bill back to the forefront of committee. Premier, during the election campaign, I heard a very discouraging story, another story, and this was from a young girl. She told me she suffered an asthma attack on the bus while traveling to school. However, due to current regulations of school board policies that do not allow children to carry the relief puffers, she had to sit through the bus ride during her asthma attack, wait till the bus got to the school, get off the bus, and then find a teacher who was responsible for giving her inhaler so that she could attain some relief. Premier, that story should frighten you. Yep. Had the attack been more severe, the outcome could have been far more tragic, just like poor Ryan in Stratfordville. That's why Ryan's Law is so important. Among other things, it permits children to carry their relief inhalers at all times, provided they have permission from the health care providers. Premier, we can't wait.
Question.
When Ryan's Law passes second reading, will you make it a priority to help it get it through committee?
Thank you
very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I said, it's very important to me that where there are situations where we can put in place a structure, put in place a law, put in place a regulation that is going to keep kids safer, then obviously, Mr. Speaker, we need to do that. And so as this piece of legislation goes through, and when it goes to committee, Mr. Speaker, then the committee needs to deal with it, but certainly to try to make sure that we put the right regulations in place. One of the things, Mr. Speaker, though, that I would need to just say to the member opposite is, first of all, there are a lot of pieces of legislation that are introduced, and a lot of them have a huge merit, Mr. Speaker. But the other thing is, we need to sort out what's school board policy and what's provincial law, where are the interactions between those things, Mr. Speaker, and
answer.
I think it's very important that as a piece of legislation like this goes through, that we examine that and make sure that it's not something that's happening at the
local
level as opposed to the provincial level that's the problem.
Thank you. Your question? The member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier, at the end of 2014, the Premier's Advisory Council on Government Assets, headed by TD CEO Ed Clark, will present recommendations to this government regarding the whole or partial privatization of the LCBO, Hydro One, and OPG. These recommendations, in turn, will be fed into the 2015 budget process. The government factors in revenues from all significant initiatives of this sort into its long-term fiscal framework. Will the government tell this House how much is slotted into the fiscal framework from the full or partial sale of these core public assets?
Thank you, Premier.
Finance.
Well, I appreciate the question, and it allows us now to talk about the relevance of reviewing the assets owned by government. Mr. Speaker, the shareholders of these assets are the people of Ontario, the taxpayer, and they have a right for us to ensure that we maximize its potential, either by way of increasing the dividends by which those crown corporations can produce, and or look at ways that we can invest our monies in appropriate manners to even greater returns by putting it through the Trillium Trust, which is part of the budget. But Mr. Speaker, we are guided by the principles that are core principles, which includes our policy objectives to maximize its value by representing the good value that it represents Ontarians. And it's also about ensuring that they work in the best interest of the public so that we do not have a repeat of the sale of the 407.
Answer.
We must ensure that we take rigorous measures to protect these assets and the annuity by which
Thank
they provide
you.
Dividends. We must have returns.
Supplementary.
Sure doesn't sound to me like they're ruling out privatization. The real fact of the matter is that after missing its 2014 deficit projection by $2.4 billion, this government has projected that its $12.5 billion deficit will magically disappear in the next 3 years. This includes a near miraculous $5.3 billion reduction in 2016-2017 alone. This is unprecedented, and no serious student of Ontario's budget believes that this kind of reduction will take place without a significant sale of core assets. How much has this government slotted into its long-term fiscal framework from the sale of LCBO, OPG, and Hydro One assets?
Mr. Speaker, it's incumbent upon the government to review the functions of these crown corporations and the assets which we hold. It doesn't mean we're selling anything. What it means is we're maximizing the potential of these crown corporations for the benefit of the shareholder, which are the people of Ontario and the taxpayer. The expert council will evaluate what it is that we own. We're going to continue our priorities to continue to investing in infrastructure and in transit, which will maximize potential being competitive in the long run. These are the principles that guide us, and it's also about ensuring that the monies that are invested by government are invested wisely for the benefit of the people of Ontario. Mr. Speaker, this is not something new. The United Kingdom Australia have adopted some of these very measures to their great benefit. What we must do is ensure that we invest in those assets that provide the maximum return
Answer.
For the taxpayer and also maximize our revenue and our value assets of those. Nothing, Mr. Speaker, at this point is being considered to be sold, although we made it clear in the budget that we're not going to be passive investors on stocks, nor should we be.
Seated, please. New question. The member from Halton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. On my first time rising in this chamber, I'd like to say what an honour and a privilege it is to be here representing the people of Halton. And congratulations on your re-election. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Associate Minister of Finance. It is the desire of our government that Ontario be the best place in the world to grow old. In the past, Ontarians and Canadians have been well served by the Canada Pension Plan. However, middle-class Canadians know that the current CPP is not adequate for their retirement. Provincial and federal government officials and pension experts agree that Canadians, especially the middle class, need more support in their retirement years. After a lifetime of work and contributing to the economy, retired Ontarians deserve better than to face plunging standards of living. Can the minister responsible for the new Ontario Retirement Pension Plan please explain how the ORPP will help Ontarians become more secure in their retirement?
Thank you, Speaker, and congratulations on your re-election. And thank you to the member from Halton for her question today. As announced in our government's May 1st budget, we are committed to building retirement security with a Made in Ontario pension plan that puts secure retirement on the horizon for every worker. The ORPP will mirror the CPP, enhancing benefits for middle-income earners while keeping contributions low. Unless we take action now, future generations of retirees will be left with a lower standard of living. And now analysis shows that a CPP enhancement will have economic benefits by growing the economy and creating jobs. Higher disposable income for future retirees means less reliance on social programs funded by taxpayers. However, the federal government has refused to accept the consensus amongst the provinces and analysis by experts to work on enhancing the CPP. We're standing up for the people of Ontario by continuing to do the right thing and building a smart, leading the way towards a pension plan that gives the people of Ontario retirement.
Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Associate Minister of Finance for the answer. Again, to the Associate Minister of Finance, I am pleased to hear you are working on a plan that will help Ontarians retire with security. My constituents in Halton are concerned that as Ontarians continue to live longer and less workplaces are offering workplace pension plans, they will not be able to save enough for their retirement. In 2012, only 34% of Ontario's population belonged to a workplace pension plan. And my younger constituents, who are expected to have multiple employers, will be more likely to encounter a patchwork of workplace coverage that will make saving for retirement even more difficult. Can the minister please explain how the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan will build on the CPP to enhance retirement benefits for Ontarians?
Good question.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you again to the industrious member from Halton. The ORPP would be the first of its kind in Canada and would be introduced in 2017 to coincide with the expected reductions in employment insurance premiums. If negotiations with the federal government on enhancing CPP were to be successful in the future, the ORPP would be integrated into the CPP. The ORPP would require equal contributions to be shared between employers and employees, not exceeding 1.9% each. It would
would aim to provide a replacement rate of 15% of individuals' earnings, up to a maximum annual earnings threshold of $90,000.
Wow.
When combined with CPP, an individual with steady career earnings over 40 years of $90,000 could replace about 30% of pre-retirement income and could receive annual benefits of about $25,000, which roughly doubles retirement benefits under the CPP alone. We are committed to providing retirement security to all Ontarians and moving ahead with the planning of ORPP, and this is just one step.
Thank you. Question, the member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Long-Term Health and Care. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care, good luck on your appointment. Minister, 2 weeks ago I received a letter from our local Community Care Access Centre stating that the organization will be limiting the number of new patients it accepts less than 3 months into their fiscal. Your government has talked a lot about investing in community care-based service, yet 10 days after the election, our local CCAC is telling me they will be limiting the number of new patients in need of care. Minister, do you support Central West CCAC's decision?
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and of course I do. It's just unfortunate that the party opposite didn't support our budget, nor did the third party, because in fact, if they had, we have in that budget, not only did we dramatically increase by $260 million our support to community care, including our CCACs in 2013, but we had laid out in the budget a further increase of $750 million increased funding to community care, including our CCACs, by 2017. So it was in the budget. Unfortunately, we had to have, as a result of the two parties opposite not supporting that budget in election to get us to this point. We are committed to our CCACs. We have invested over the past number of years a significant increase in our CCACs to make sure that we're providing that care, that quality care, to individuals and their families when they need it, where they need it, and as close to home as possible, Mr. Speaker.
Minister, I understand that you're new, but this letter came out on June 23rd, which would be post-election, which would be post after you announced that the same budget is coming through. So clearly, the local CCAC is going to have the same problem. I understand you've inherited a number of crises in the health portfolio, but there really is an opportunity to make a difference here. This is a matter of priorities. Last week in the throne speech, we heard a lot of talk about building Ontario up. Well, I can tell you that in Dufferin-Caledon, we don't believe in building Ontario up by clawing back access to health care service. So I will ask the minister again, will you do the right thing and direct the local CCAC to prioritize their decisions to ensure that all patients are provided with the health care service they need when they need it?
I'm going to ask the member to withdraw. Thank you. Minister of Health.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, we are committed to our CCACs. And in fact, the funding to our CCACs has increased by 99% since 2003. We have further investments that we're making in the budget. I think this speaks to the imperative, Mr. Speaker, of making sure that the budget, which has been tabled, is quickly debated and passed in the coming days so we can go ahead and continue to invest and increase our investment to this important aspect of the continuum of health care. Mr. Speaker, we know that there's always more work to be done. I'm very proud of the work that's been done in the past number of years to make home care and funding for supportive services. In fact, in our budget, as individuals are aware, we're increasing the
the member from Dufferin-Caledon asked the question.
Personal
order,
support
please.
Workers, a key provider of our support services in our home care. We're increasing that by 30% over the next few years, Mr. Speaker. So there is more work to be done. We need to start by passing the budget.
That's right.
Your question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Families across Ontario are struggling to find safe, affordable childcare for their kids, while this government is making the crisis even worse by cutting childcare funding to 18 communities across our province. Childcare centres like Coronation Park Day Nursery, in Sarnia are on the chopping block, Speaker. Over 100 kids at that centre are at risk of losing access to childcare in Sarnia alone. Can the Premier explain to parents in Sarnia and across our province why her government is intent on shutting down childcare centres that families rely upon?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, since 2003, childcare funding in Ontario has increased by from $532.4 million to close to $1 billion. That's a 90% increase, Mr. Speaker. So, in fact, quite contrary to what the leader of the third party is saying, that we're cutting funding to childcare, we're actually increasing funding to childcare. But there are two things happening. One is that full-day kindergarten is being implemented, Mr. Speaker, across the province, so that every 4- and 5-year-old in Ontario in September will have access to a full-day kindergarten program. And that means that there are changes within the child care system, Mr. Speaker. There's no doubt about that. And so we are working with the system. We are changing the funding formula, Mr. Speaker. We recognize that as those 4- and 5-year-olds are in full-day kindergarten, there are changes that happen within the preschool child care system. So we will continue to invest. We will continue to work with the system as we change the funding formula. But, Mr. Speaker, our support for child care is steadfast and will remain so.
Thank you.
I think the Premier just admitted that she's created a crisis in the child care system. The Premier's Trojan horse budget, in fact, does nothing to stop the child care cuts in 18 communities. When only 1 in 5 kids can access licensed child care in this province, no community can afford cuts to child care funding. No community should be forced to close the doors on their licensed child care centres in this province. And no family should have to worry about losing their kids' spot in child care. But this government has decided that services will be cut, and child care happens to be the first to go. Why won't the Premier do the right thing and commit today to stop the cuts in the child care centres in Sarnia and all 18 communities across this province? Why doesn't she just commit today to do the right thing by these families and these children in these 18 communities? Speaker?
Thank you. Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, nearly 90,000 new spaces in child care since 2003. There are tens of thousands of new child care spaces in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. The fact is that we are going through a transition. There is no doubt about that. And I, you know, I would hope that the leader of the third party and her colleagues would be able to understand and work with their communities as we go through the transition. 4- and 5-year-olds are going to be in full-day kindergarten as of September. All 4- and 5-year-olds have access now to full-day kindergarten. So what we need to do is we need to make sure that the child care system adjusts to that so that the preschool kids, the 0- to 3-year-old kids, have the opportunity to be in the child care system, that we have before and after care for students, Mr. Speaker. Those are changes, Mr. Speaker. That means the system is going through a transformation. We have put mitigation funding in place. We will continue to work with the child care system. But to suggest that not having full-day kindergarten would be a good thing, Mr. Speaker, is not in the best interest of kids. And that's essentially what the leader of the third party is.
Thank you. New question. The member from Burlington.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank my constituents in the riding of Burlington for their confidence. My question is for the Minister of Transportation. Speaker, my riding of Burlington is a beautiful place to ride a bike. From our waterfront to our trails to our on-road facilities, cycling makes an important contribution to a more healthy, active, and connected Burlington. Indeed, cycling is not only good for my community, it enhances the health and well-being of my constituents. Cycling is good for economic development and tourism, too, as witnessed by bicycle tourism initiatives like the Greenbelt and our beautiful waterfront trail. That's why, Speaker, I'm proud to be a part of a government that is committed to supporting cycling and cyclists across Ontario. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can you please explain to this House what our government is doing to support and promote cycling and cyclists on every path, trail, and roadway?
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to begin by thanking the newly elected member for Burlington for that outstanding question and for welcoming her to Ontario's legislature. I also want to thank the member for her tireless support for such a great cause, the cause of cycling here in our province. Because of her advocacy and her passion for safe roads in our province, we have a vision for cycling in Ontario that all of us can be proud of. And I also want to quickly pay tribute to the Minister of Environment and Climate Change, who played a leadership role in making sure that we brought this project forward. In August 2013, Speaker, our government introduced Cycle On, the most comprehensive cycling strategy that Ontario has ever seen. This strategy touches many parts of our government and will play a large role in building healthier and stronger communities. $10 million over 3 years through a new cost-shared program that will help municipalities expand their local and cycling networks. And in addition, $15 million over 3 years will be dedicated to investments in cycling infrastructure. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that answer. I agree with you that the benefits of cycling are limitless for our communities, our economies, and our health. Cycling connects Ontarians to communities and to each other. That is why support for cities and municipalities is vital to the promotion of cycling. Speaker, through you, I'd like the Minister to elaborate on what we can expect for cycling as our government rolls out Cycle On, the Ontario Cycling Strategy, and on how communities across Ontario will benefit.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the member again for that great supplementary. We are coming up on the one-year anniversary of our Cycle On strategy, and last August we released our long-term 20-year vision based on five strategic directions to encourage the growth of cycling and to improve safety for cyclists across the province. Cycle On is to be implemented through ongoing multi-year action plans. And the first action plan, Speaker, that was introduced at the Ontario Bike Summit earlier this year will focus on year one commitments, but includes many initiatives to be implemented with partners over years 2 to 5. Develop with stakeholders, including AMO, CAA, Share the Road, suggestions from the Chief Coroner's 2012 review and public comments. This plan will help Ontarians continue to move forward with a progressive and balanced and responsible cycling strategy. Remember, Speaker, sharing the road and having a great time doing it is what cycling in Ontario is all about. Cycle On.
Thank you. Any questions? The member from Chatham-Kent, Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, before I begin, I just would like to congratulate you on your re-election as Speaker of the House.
Very, very good.
My question is to the Premier. Premier, as the election began, Chief Electoral Officer Greg Essenga, repeated his call for a limit on third-party advertising. Mr. Essenga stated, and I quote, "When I look across the country, we are the only jurisdiction that has no spending limit." He went on to say the process is completely non-transparent. We may never know just how much these groups spent. Dalton McGuinty's 05 and 07 legislation added little transparency, leaving the Chief Electoral Officer asking for more reforms. Premier, this is your chance to prove to the people of Ontario that you are different. And since you are in an open and transparent mood today, are you willing to protect the integrity of democracy
and
pledge to limit place limits on third-party advertising spending?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question from the member of the opposition, and I endeavor always to be in an open and transparent mood. So thank you very much. So, Mr. Speaker, we have rules in place to ensure that there's both transparency and free speech in our election campaigns, and those things have to be balanced. And we are the party that introduced third-party advertising rules in Ontario for the first time in 2007, Mr. Speaker. And under current rules, third parties that spend $500 or more on election advertising are required to register with the Chief Electoral Officer, so that there actually is an accounting for how that money is spent. And registered third parties also have to report to the Chief Electoral Officer on election advertising expenses. If election advertising expenses are $5,000 or more, then those reports have to be audited. Mr. Speaker, so we have taken many steps to make sure that there is openness in this process.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, Premier, that's the same answer you gave me in the fall when I introduced my Bill 101. But you know, Speaker, we are the only jurisdiction in Canada that has no spending limitation on advertisers that have the power to influence elections. That jeopardizes the integrity of this institution and is a disservice to our democracy. The chief electoral officer recommends that no group should be able to spend millions of dollars to influence elections without any transparency. And, Premier, we agree. The status quo is setting the stage for corruption. Premier, will you implement the chief electoral officer's recommendations?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, let me just say that I disagree that there is no transparency, because I think that there have been steps taken by our government to put in place transparency. But having said that, Mr. Speaker, we're always open to conversations on ways to improve Ontario's electoral process. Third parties supported all three parties during the election campaign, Mr. Speaker. So there's not a difference in terms of the treatment party by party. But if there is a willingness and a desire on the part of all parties and the chief electoral officer to have a conversation, we're open to having that conversation, Mr. Speaker. But I think it's something that everyone needs to take part in.
Thank you. New question, member from Elm.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier. People across the Northwest are still suffering from record-high water levels and flooding that started last month, with as many as 10 communities in my riding alone declaring states of emergency. I toured the area and I saw firsthand the devastation. Homes overwhelmed by flooding, sections of highway completely washed away, significant erosion of shoreline resulting in lost personal property and a threatened cemetery, and evacuations. People in the Northwest are doing an amazing job banding together in this difficult time, but it is up to this government to ensure that there are funds necessary available for cleanup and recovery. A couple of years ago, when Thunder Bay experienced a similar emergency, it had to wait over a year to receive provincial assistance from this government. People in my riding simply can't wait that long. Will the Premier help the people of Kenora-Rainy River today by committing funds from the Ontario Disaster Relief Assistance Program to provide badly needed relief to these 10 hard-hit communities and commit to a timeline
question.
Of when we can expect this funding?
Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Natural Resources.
The Minister of Natural Resources.
Speaker, thank you very much. I want to thank the member for the question, but I do want to say that the assertion that after the Thunder Bay flood, our government was slow to respond. In fact, not only did we meet our commitments on providing assistance to the city of Thunder Bay, but in fact, we've exceeded our commitment through the ODRAP programming under MMAH. In terms of the flooding that's occurring in the members' communities, of course we're aware of it. Of course, it is a very, very serious and significant occurrence. Unfortunately, it seems like we find ourselves in these situations all too regularly now. And in fact, these what were abnormal weather events seem to be occurring on a far too regular basis. I can tell the member I've been in direct contact with the mayors of the three potentially directly affected communities, in fact, those that have been directly affected, Mayor Avis in Fort Francis, Mayor Brown in Atikokan, Mayor Canfield in Kenora. I've talked to them. They've been very pleased to this point. I would say that the outreach that's been provided and the support that's been provided by all of the appropriate ministries, including M&R, we continue to monitor the situation. I've asked them to contact me at any time that they feel
Thank
necessary
you.
If they're at some point Stay uncertain here. With the response that's coming.
Thank you. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon. And I know who my usual suspects are now, and I appreciate being given that opportunity to know who they are.